For those of you who may not have used the Stations of the Cross before, they are a devotion which many Christians use as a means of helping them as they themselves walk with Christ on his journey to the cross. They are a reminder of the Via Dolorosa, or the way of the cross in Jerusalem, believed by many to be the actual path that Jesus took on his way to the cross. The images that you will see on your screen are those from St. Mary's Church here in Sanderstead, and I hope that they will help visually to transport you as well as remind you of the experiences that Jesus went through on his way to Calvary. I hope that as we journey together with the now risen Lord, you will find the reflections and prayers helpful in your own contemplation of his passion. The reflection and prayers that we will use today have been written by Monsignor Matthew Dickens in his book Steps of Pain, Steps of Hope. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus told his disciples, "If any of you wants to be my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." The peace of the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, to take upon himself our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and may also be partakers of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. The first station. Jesus is condemned to death. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Pilate asked, "What harm has he done?" But they shouted all the louder, "Let him be crucified." As procurator of Judea, Pontius Pilate was tasked with the smooth running of this particularly troublesome corner of the Roman Empire. He needed stability, and he would have it, whatever the cost. Although in his conscience he knew that Jesus was an innocent man, to avoid civil disturbance, he handed him over to the crowd and to certain death. In the exercise of authority, it is often easier to choose the politically expedient solution rather than to stand up for justice and truth. Our minds can find all sorts of ways to justify the evasion of truth. When we do this, we are no better than Pilate washing his hands, for we have failed to take responsibility. Lord, forgive the abuse of power in whatever form it takes. Give us courage to stand up and be counted, to defend the innocent and marginalised. For you will call us to account for what we say and do. Strengthen us then to proclaim the truth and justice of your kingdom. The second station, Jesus takes up his cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Carrying his own cross, he went to the place of the skull, or as it is called in Hebrew, Golgotha. The Roman method of crucifixion was not only physical torture, it was psychological as well. The condemned person was forced to carry the instrument of their own death through the baying, hysterical mob. There was no mercy here, nothing to ease the mind from the physical suffering to come. Jesus was ridiculed, taunted and spat upon, a man deprived of every human dignity as he began his journey to Golgotha. We recoil at such inhumanity, such grotesque violence. Yet this cruelty exists among us when a child is neglected or abused, or when an elderly person is terrorized and beaten up. These things bring shame on our society. Lord, as we see you, accept the instrument of your suffering and death. Help us to understand how small our sufferings often are in comparison with yours. We cannot make this journey with you except by carrying our share of your cross. Help us to walk with courage, uniting our suffering with yours. Do not let us vanish into the crowd, but strengthen us to stand and protect those who are most vulnerable. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The third station, Jesus falls for the first time. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. He was so inhumanly disfigured that he no longer looked like a man. It seems that Jesus had not gone very far before falling under the weight of the cross. This is no surprise. He had already been lashed, the flesh of his back opened by the scourge's whip. Blood smeared his face as it ran from the gashes made by the crown of thorns that had been rammed upon his head. No wonder he could not balance the beam's weight on his shoulders, but fell in the dust beneath them. Some onlookers no doubt laughed at this pitiful sight, ruefully recalling that this was the same man who had entered Jerusalem in triumph only a few days before. Sometimes we feel we have not travelled very far before some persistent sin throws us to the ground again. We leave confession with every good intent, but are quickly depressed by our own moral weakness. Jesus' fall reminds us that while his falls were purely physical, he nevertheless knows how hard it can be to lift ourselves out of sins that are deeply ingrained in our lives. We are then to find courage and hope in this fall of Jesus, and to know that while he cannot help them stand up, Jesus can help us. Lord, help me to raise myself again, even if I sin many, many times. Help me to use your sacrament of forgiveness to heal and strengthen me. Let despair not take its hold, but let your humanity encourage me to try again. The fourth station, Jesus meets his mother. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. He has pulled down princes from their thrones and raised high the lowly. From the moment of the Incarnation, Mary's life had revolved around her son. She had borne him, nurtured him, and comforted him as every loving mother does her child. She had seen him grow into a man and had to watch as his public life led him deeper and deeper into conflict with the religious authorities. Never, though, would she forget the words of Simeon, that a sword shall pierce your own heart too. How sharp that sword must have felt now as she gazed on her suffering son. We don't know if any words passed between Mary and Jesus in this moment that they shared together. Language is so often inadequate to express our deepest feelings, and profound love is sometimes shared silently. All Mary's love for her son was expressed in her eyes as she looked at him, and Jesus knew that his mother would be with him to the end. Lord, we thank you for the people whose love have sustained us, especially in the darkest moments of our lives. We entrust them all to your safekeeping. Help us and all your church to express love with or without words. Bless those who you call to stand silently beside those who suffer, and let your healing peace flow through them. The fifth station, Simon of Cyrene helps Jesus carry his cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. They enlisted a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus, who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. Simon was just a bystander who was called out of the crowd to assist Jesus carry his cross. Probably he had little desire to be caught up in this demeaning spectacle and may well have resented being forced to take part in it. Yet Simon's encounter with Jesus so moved him that he became a true disciple and passed his faith to his sons Alexander and Rufus. We are sometimes called to take responsibilities that we find onerous and daunting, feeling that we may not be up to the task. We would rather be left alone to carry on as we always have done. Change can disturb our comfort and undermine our sense of security. But we do not know what we are capable of until something we have not chosen to do is demanded of us. Then we can discover that what daunted us, in fact, is an opportunity to grow in faith. Lord, when we are confronted with challenges in life that alarm or distress us, help us to see that it is in saying yes to life that we discover who we truly are. Help us to shake off our complacency and fear of change that stunts our growth. May we seize those grace-filled moments that draw us more deeply into your life and that change us forever. The sixth station. Jesus falls a second time. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Even with the help of Simon, Jesus was unable to steady himself enough to avoid falling a second time under the weight of the cross. While Simon could share the physical load of the timber's weight, he could not share with Jesus the burden of humanity's sin. That weight Jesus had to carry by himself, because only he is free from sin. He alone is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. only by his death and resurrection could that burden finally be put down. The spiritual reality of what Jesus was going through as he staggered to Golgotha is quite beyond our grasp. Our own sins seem bad enough, but the sins of every man, woman and child from the fall to the end of time, this is simply too much for our understanding. It leaves us speechless, but shows us the enormity of the Father's love, that he should give his Son into our hands to suffer and to die for us. Lord, the immensity of your love is beyond our comprehension. As we stand in awe at what your Son endured for our salvation, strengthen us and all who profess the Christian faith to live by your commandments. May we love you with all our heart, soul, strength and mind, and our neighbours as ourselves. The seventh station, Jesus meets the women of Jerusalem. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, weep rather for yourselves and for your children. A group of women gathered at the roadside, weeping at the sight of the disfigured Jesus as he struggled past them. Their sorrow was real, but Jesus told them to weep not for him, but for themselves and for their children. He knew that their grief would be even greater when the persecution of the Roman occupation claimed the lives of their own loved ones. How many women in human history have had to grieve the violent death of their children? In our own day, terrorism makes no distinction between male or female, military or civilian, adult or child. Even our most sophisticated military technology cannot guarantee safety from the homemade roadside bomb or the suicide bombers. Wherever there is violent conflict, men and women will grieve the loss of loved ones. Lord, let your church speak boldly for reconciliation in our war-torn world. Turn the hearts of men and women of violence to peace, that all people may live without fear of conflict. For we are one human family. Help us to restore the trust that has been lost. The eighth station, Jesus falls a third time. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. He had no form or charm to attract us, no beauty to win our hearts. He was despised, the lowest of men, a man of sorrows, familiar with suffering. As Jesus neared the place of execution, he again collapsed under the weight of the cross. His frame ached with exhaustion, but he knew the worst was still to come. It would not be long before the wood that brought him to the ground would hold him in agony above the earth. We sometimes muse on the manner of our death. Will it be a sudden end of which we know little, or a protracted ebbing away of life as disease gradually claims our bodies? Will we suffer pain or slip gently away? Will there be loved ones with us, or will we face the final mystery on our own? Whatever the circumstances of our death, our Christian faith calls us to take each day as an opportunity to grow in love for God. even the frailest person at the end of life, can radiate hope and joy, somehow overcoming the indignity of illness. There is no situation which cannot be used by God to reveal something of Himself. Lord, when I approach my end, give me courage to place my trust in your mercy and forgiveness. Sustain me by the prayers of your church and give me the comfort of the sacraments which will bring the risen Lord to me when my strength has gone. Let me know how deep within my heart that you are with me and that you too have felt your life slip from your grasp. The ninth station, Jesus is stripped of his garments. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Then they crucified him and shared out his clothing, casting lots to decide what each should get. Jesus had now reached the place of his execution, and the final acts of degradation were about to take place. The soldiers removed his clothes, stripping him not only of his garments, but the last vestige of his dignity. One is reminded of photographs of the Nazi concentration camps, with prisoners stripped naked and even their hair shaven off. Forced nakedness is a gross violation of a person's right to honour and respect. The dying hours of the Son of Man were spent in nakedness, naked before God the Father, naked before his mother and the disciple whom he loved, naked before anyone curious to see the King of the Jews. We too look on his nakedness, ashamed that human beings can so degrade one of their own kind. If Jesus was forced to show himself to us like this, why do we try and cover up the reality of who we truly are? Lord, your nakedness teaches us that we should not try to conceal anything of ourselves from you. You know who we are already, but so often we are afraid to approach you in our inner nakedness. Give us courage to stand before you as we really are. The tenth station, Jesus is nailed to the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. When they reached the place called the Skull, there they crucified him and the two criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus had been trained in the carpenter's trade. As a boy, he must have watched Joseph hammering nails into wood, and as he learned his craft, he would have become familiar with the smell and feel of timber. Now the materials that had been his livelihood become the instruments of his death. Great iron spikes were driven through the hands and feet, staking him to the wooden beams. Then pulled up by ropes, he was raised high above the ground. Torture remains commonplace in parts of the world today, used as a means of punishment or to extract information. Many of those seeking asylum in this country are refugees from state-sponsored torture. They do not always find a welcome here. Lord, you suffered one of the vilest forms of punishment ever devised. In this you identify yourself with every man, woman and child who suffers any form of torture. Be with those who dread the opening of their prison cell door, and strengthen all who campaign against the use of terror and intimidation. the 11th station, Jesus dies on the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. After Jesus had taken the wine, he said, "It is accomplished." And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. On the evening of his arrest, Jesus had celebrated the Passover meal with his disciples. At the Last Supper, he offered them the unleavened bread, saying, "This is my body," and the wine, saying, "This is my blood." Under the forms of bread and wine, he gave them the fullness of himself. Deserted now by all except his mother and John, Jesus truly became the Lamb of sacrifice, pouring out his lifeblood on the altar of the cross. Every time we celebrate Holy Communion, we remember and make present the saving death of Jesus. In this sacred act, we are caught up in the self-offering of Jesus to the Father, making of ourselves a living sacrifice to the glory of his name. And we are nourished by his body and his blood, the food of eternal life. Lord, without your death and resurrection, our dying would be eternal obliteration. With your death and resurrection, our dying becomes the opening to eternal life. At the moment of our death, plunge us in the healing power of your redeeming love, that we may journey on to our eternal home. The 12th station, Jesus is taken down from the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nothing already in existence and nothing still to come, nor any power, nor heights, nor depths, nor any created thing will be able to come between us and the love of God known to us in Christ Jesus our Lord. The Pietà, the dead body of Jesus held in his mother's arms, is one of the great images of Christian art. Often Mary is portrayed with great dignity, a depth of faith sustaining her in the moment of profound grief. Yet surely it would be no compromise of faith if, in this most human scene, Mary had felt that surge of pain that shakes our whole body with grief. Her tears and her cries came not from a lack of faith, but from the utter love she had for her child. In the midst of her grief, Mary knew that somehow, somewhere, the death of her son would not be the end of his life. The promise made her, by the angel, that his reign would last forever, could not. So she continued to believe, despite the dead weight of her son upon her lap. Lord, in the midst of despair, you call your people to believe, to trust, and to hope. When the darkness of night tries to overwhelm us, remind us that the light of dawn is not far away. The 13th station, Jesus is laid in the tomb. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean shroud, and put it in his own tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a large stone across the entrance of the tomb and went away. Joseph of Arimathea was a good man, a member of the Sanhedrin and a secret disciple of Jesus. He requested of Pilate the dead body of Jesus and laid it in his own family tomb. It was an act of noble generosity to dignify the body of Jesus with Jewish burial ritual and to lay it to rest. Mary of Magdala and the other women stayed outside of the tomb weeping and praying. After the liturgy of Good Friday, a deep silence falls on the church. It is a time of prayerful waiting, of noiseless anticipation before the Easter Vigil can begin. In those mysterious hours, when Jesus' body lay in the tomb, while the women prayed, the seed of new life was germinating, life that would overcome the power of sin and death. Lord, your Spirit moves in the depths of our hearts, unseen and unheard. Even death has been transformed by your presence, and so there is nothing that you cannot touch and heal. Forgive all that is in us that denies your love, and reform us in the image of your Son, Jesus. Let us pray. In the fullness of the risen Lord Jesus, given by his Holy Spirit, we express our gratitude for this way of the cross. We ask our Lord and Master, whose hands and feet and side still bear the signs of this journey, to grant us the grace that we need to take up our own cross and follow him. And so let us pray together the words that are coming up on your screen. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for all the benefits that you have won for us, for all the pains and insults that you have borne for us. Most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, fill us afresh with your Holy Spirit and transform us into your likeness. Almighty God, as we stand at the foot of your cross, may we know this day your love for us, that in humility, love and joy, we may place at your feet all that we have, all that we are, and all that we hope to be. Amen. Most merciful God, who by the death and resurrection of your Son, delivered and saved humanity, grant that by our faith in him who suffered on the cross, we may triumph in the power of his victory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always, now and forever. Amen.